intraoral mucosal flaps for undergraduate, it's very important to know about this development of these flaps. So as we know that these flaps are of what we call annular flap, triangular flap, quadrangular flap, semilunar flap. Nowadays the recent modification that is going to be the submarginal flap. So what are these flaps? We'll see first. So these flaps, when you any intraoral procedure, surgical procedure need to be carried out, we'll be using any one of these flaps. It depends upon the operator preference or maybe the accessibility which is required to manage the underlying pathology. So annular flap, as you are able to see here, sir, is going to be placing the sulcular incision along the crevices of the tooth. This is called as a horizontal incision, what we place. And when you place a horizontal incision along the crevices or a sulcular incision, then you have to raise this flap. So when you raise this flap, this is called as only annular flap. The disadvantage with this flap is the limited accessibility along the periapical region, as well as there is of course what you call the marginal slight recession is going to be there in the postoperative healing. Or whenever, because to avoid these problems, maybe what you call the inaccessibility, then we can add one more vertical incision along this line. You can see this. This is called as a what you call triangular flap. So it means one horizontal, along with the horizontal one incision, then we are going to place one more vertical incision that is going to called as a triangular. Why triangular? Because there's always a base, what you call, three surfaces are there on this flap also, you can see. So it's called as a triangular flap. Next one is that is quadrangular. So with this triangular flap also, if the sufficient accessibility is not going to be there, so obviously that time we have to place one more second incision, vertical releasing incision. So then the flap, the shape of the flap itself become a quadrangular flap. So it means that one is first annular flap with a simple horizontal incision, and then the adding one vertical incision, that is becomes a triangular flap. Adding one more vertical incision, this will to that, that's going to become a quadrangular flap. These are the three common flaps which are used. The disadvantage with all these flaps are going to be what you call the slight gingival recession is going to be there always in the post-operative healing period. But definitely the fantastic, what you call, your accessibility is going to be there if you are taking, doing a surgical extraction. Next flap, that is a margin. Suppose if you are doing for a periapical surgical procedures, it is preferred to have a semilunar flap. The advantage of this flap is that this, you are not disturbing the gingival attachment here. The marginal epithelium is not going to be recession, it's not going to be there in the postoperative period. And direct accessibility for the periapical region. Whereas in case of a triangular or a rectangular flap, quadrangular flap, you can see that we have to completely reflect in the periapical region. So it's always preferred to have a submarginal flap or what you call your semilunar flap when you're doing a periapical surgeries. To prevent this, what you call the recession of this, nowadays a recent modification that is submarginal flap, where the horizontal incision, instead of placing the circular region, it is always placed 5 mm away from the marginal gingiva, so that this recession can be avoided. When you are developing these flaps, we have to remember few points that we'll discuss. That is, what you call this, the base of the flap should be broader than the coronal part, whereas the, you can see in these pictures, that is, you can see this here, this base of the flap is broader than the coronal part of the flap. This is the first principle what you have to follow. Otherwise, you can see this, if you place it like this, what happens? The corner of this flap is going to have become necrosed. That's the reason, this always the base of the flap is broader than the coronal part of this flap. That's the first thing we have to say. And next one is, whenever you're placing a vertical releasing incision, this should always be placed down to the what you call one of the line angle of the flap. You can see this line angle where the buccal surface and the mesial surface is junction. That is called a line angle that should be placed. With this incision, you can preserve the papilla of this adjacent tooth. And meantime, we should not place the incision onto the convex part of the tooth, because then if you place the incision onto the what you call your convex region, what you call convexity of the bone, the postoperative is going to be delayed. That's the reason you have to always place incision, vertical releasing incision, in the what you call line angle of the tooth. That is the second principle what you are supposed to follow. Suppose if at all this, what you call the sinus is there in this region, that should always be included in the flap. That is the third principle what you are supposed to follow. And when you, suppose if you are working in this area, then you have to plan properly how much amount of the bone you are going to take out. And then the, why they should plan out, based upon that only you can do, what you call width of the flap can be increased. And why? Because the margin of the flap should always be resting onto the sound bone when after post, what you call, when you suture it back. That's the reason you have to always make sure the vertical incision should always be placing onto the, what you call, underlying bony support should always be required. And next, that is, whenever you're placing an incision, that incision should be placed a single stroke. Not that always like make a small incision, vertical incision, and again lift the blade again, making it incision. With this, what happens? Rough margin of the border of the flap is going to develop. That itself can cause a what is called a delayed wound healing. That's the reason whenever you place the incision, you should be placed in single stroke to the what you call muco. Whenever single stroke, you should be able to cut the mucous membrane as well as the periosteum, not gentle mucosa and later the periosteum. That directly is going to cause a delayed wound healing. That's the reason the basic principle of flap design has to be there. Once you place the incision, you should always use a periosteal elevator, that is a convex part, has to be facing the soft tissue side. It means that the bony part of the, what you call the concave part of the periosteal elevator should be pressed against the bone. Here, when you're deflecting the flap, you should always think that, okay, your job is to deflect, what you call, press the instrument onto the bone surface, so naturally the flap will be raising on its own. Instead of starting from the attached gingiva, rather start from the unattached gingiva so that the plane of a cleavage can develop and easily the attached gingiva can be removed. When you're raising this flap from the periosteal elevator, use the sharp end of the periosteal elevator to raise from the attached gingiva. So that the sharp end is meant for only to reflect the soft, what you call the attached gingiva, and the bone, spoon shape is used for the, what you call your reflect from the unattached side. So these are basic principles what we're supposed to, what you call, follow when you are placing an incision. When you suture, what you call, that one more principle, that is when you suture back, you should be always suturing on the corners of the flap, not the start suturing from one side and then continue on to the other side. What happens is the papilla is going to be shifted. That's the reason you should always suture, what you call, from the this margin as well as this side margin, so that the flap is in its proper position in the post-operative period.